First of all, I'd like to thank the organizers for the kind invitation and for giving me the opportunity to hold this talk on the intriguing but still controversial topic of gluten and wheat sensitivity. I have no conflict of interest to declare, and the worldwide growing consumption of wheat containing foods such as pasta, bread, and pizza, with a mean gluten ingestion of 15-30 grams in a day, has contributed to a significant increase to the incidence of gluten wheat-related disorders. Moreover, new variants of wheat have arisen as a result of the mechanization of farming and of the growing industrial use of pesticides and fertilizers, and these factors could have a leading role in the adverse reaction to gluten and wheat. And finally, the addition of vital gluten to the dough and the shortened process of bread leavening have led to an increased concentration of toxic gluten peptides in bakery products. The galaxy of wheat-related disorders has recently been reassessed during fourth consensus conferences held in London, Munich, Salerno and Merano from 2011 to 2016. Together with celiac disease and its related autoimmune conditions such as dermatitis herpetiformis and gluten ataxia, and the group of IgE and non-IgE mediated wheat allergy, a new syndrome has been identified, and this syndrome has been defined with the term of non-celiac gluten wheat sensitivity. This term has been coined mainly to differentiate this syndrome from the clinically superimposable celiac disease. Non-celiac gluten wheat sensitivity can be defined as an adverse reaction to gluten and other wheat proteins, mainly amylase trypsin inhibitors, characterized by gastrointestinal IBS-like and extraintestinal symptoms occurring soon after a few hours or days after gluten wheat ingestion, improving after gluten wheat withdrawal very soon, and relapsing after gluten wheat challenge in a few hours or days. Prerequisite for suspecting this syndrome is the previous exclusion of both celiac disease and wheat allergy by an appropriate investigation. Non-celiac gluten wheat sensitivity can be regarded as a mixed bag, likely with many culprits involved, including gluten, whose role has been confirmed at least in a proportion of patients with double-blind placebo-controlled trials, including also amylase trypsin inhibitors, which can trigger both intestinal and extraintestinal symptoms in non-celiac gluten wheat sensitivity. And moreover, wheat contains also fructans, which are rich of fermentable oligodisaccharides, monosaccharides, and polyols, defined with acronyms of FODMAPs, and the FODMAPs can probably be responsible for intestinal symptoms in this syndrome, such as bloating and abdominal pain. The role of gluten ATIs in this syndrome is characterized by modulation of intestinal permeability, of intestinal microbiota, and by mast cell degranulation. And finally, by stimulation of gut-brain axis due to the opioid activity of gluten peptides. Moreover, FODMAPs can lead to fermentation and gas production with luminal distension and mechanoreceptor activation, leading to stimulation of gut-brain axis. The pathogenesis of non-celiac gluten wheat sensitivity is still undefined. Innate immunity seems to be more involved than adaptive immunity, as shown by the increased intestinal secretion of toll-like receptors, by the increased serum secretion of gluten-stimulated cytokine from peripheral blood mononuclear cells, and by the increased number of innate lymphoid cells, ILC1, with gluten intrarectal challenge. However, some findings, such as the increased intestinal secretion of interferon gamma from CD4-positive T cells, as well as the increased serum secretion of antibodies to native gliadin of IgG and IgM classes, and antibodies to microbial antigens, support a possible role for adaptive immunity in this syndrome. An increased small intestinal permeability has been shown in non-celiac gluten yield sensitivity by several studies, and an increased small intestinal permeability was shown by lactulose mannitol test in patients with IBS and gluten sensitivity, sharing the DQ2 and DQ8 positivity. And moreover, zonulin upregulation with the disassembly of intercellular tight junctions has been shown in non-celiac gluten-sensitive patients by studying intestinal biopsies exposed in vitro to gliadin. And more recently, an interesting study showed the high duodenal myosin-like chain kinase activity and elevated colonocyte Claudin-15 expression, both markers of increased intestinal permeability in patients with symptomatic gluten sensitivity. Both alterations were reversible after gluten-free diet, together with disappearance of symptoms. Experimental data in HLA-DQ8mice sensitized by gliadin showed the gut microbiome may contribute to enhance the inflammatory response to gluten. Therefore, as already shown in humans for celiac disease as well as for IBS and IBD, dysbiosis may potentially trigger clinical manifestations in this syndrome. Epidemiological data on non-celiac gluten yield sensitivity are still scant and undefined. In USA, the supposed prevalence of this syndrome ranges from 0.6% in primary care to 6% in tertiary care, shown in the center of Baltimore. Whereas in an Italian multicenter study coordinated by myself, the observed prevalence resulted to be 3.2% over more than 12,000 people examined in 38 tertiary care centers. This multicenter Italian survey showed that non-celiac gluten yield sensitivity is much more frequent in young adult females, with a female-male ratio of 5 to 1, with a mean age of 38 years, being rare in childhood and in the elderly. The two most frequent gastrointestinal symptoms were bloating and abdominal pain, found in more than 80% of cases, followed by diarrhea, detected in 50% of patients, and by a series of upper gastrointestinal tract manifestations, whereas only a minority of patients showed constipation and alternating bowel habits. As for extraintestinal manifestations, three main targets have been observed in this syndrome, represented by brain, skin, and joint muscle systems. The most frequent manifestations were the neurological ones, characterized by headache, anxiety, foggy mind, numbness, observed from 30% to 50% of patients. About 30% of patients had a joint muscle pain with the typical features of fibromyalgia-like syndrome, and 30% of patients showed dermatitis and skin rash. In one third of patients with non-celiac gluten yield sensitivity, a food intolerance was observed, more frequently lactose intolerance and more rarely fructose intolerance. About 20% of these patients showed an IgE-mediated allergy, more frequently directed against mites, graminaceae, parietaria, shellfish, and other food antigens. A nickel allergy was detected in 15% of these patients. As for autoimmune disorders, these conditions were detected in about 14% of these patients, being mainly represented by Hashimoto thyroiditis, autoimmune gastritis, psoriasis, and alopecia areata. A systematic review of the literature pointed out that up to 18% of patients with non-celiac gluten sensitivity has a family history of celiac disease, so it's very common to find patients with celiac disease in the relatives of the subjects. And malabsorption signs represented by low levels of ferritin, folic acid, for vitamin D and vitamin B12 have been observed in up to 30% of these patients, likely as an expression of microinflammation at intestinal level. In line with these findings, the intestinal biopsy of these patients is characterized in 30% of cases by an increased number of intraepithelial lymphocytes with the typical features of a MASH1 lesion, whereas in the remaining 70% of patients the mucosa results to be normal. In some cases, a CD3 positive lymphocytes with a linear distribution in the deeper part of the mucosa or in clusters in the villi have been observed, and this pattern has been claimed as a possible histological pattern for this syndrome. No correlation has been found so far between this syndrome and the genetic pattern. In particular, there is no correlation with non-celiac gluten with sensitivity in HLA, DQ2, and DQ8, the well-known genetic markers of celiac disease. And although this is still debatable whether non-celiac gluten with sensitivity is a transient or a persistent condition, a recent paper fuels the theory that this condition is a chronic disease, like celiac disease. In this study, 200 patients with non-celiac gluten with sensitivity confirmed after double-blind placebo-controlled trials were followed up for 8 years. 148 of them were still on a gluten-free diet, whereas 52 of them came back to a gluten-containing diet. 98% of those still on a gluten-free diet were symptom-free, versus 58% of those coming back to a gluten-containing diet. This difference was statistically significant, confirming that the reintroduction of gluten was responsible for the recurrence of symptoms. In the CERTS Consensus Conference of Non-Celiac Gluten with Sensitivity held in Salerno in 2014, the panel of experts agreed to change the diagnostic approach for this syndrome, switching from an exclusion diagnosis to a diagnosis based on positive criteria through 3 items. The evaluation of symptom variation after gluten-free diet by a modified version of the gastrointestinal symptom rating scale, including also extraintestinal manifestations, the identification of biomarkers, and the standardization of a double-blind placebo-controlled trial as confirmatory diagnostic test. Each patient should be assessed by the questionnaire, by the modified version of the gastrointestinal symptom rating scale at baseline on a gluten-containing diet, and for 6 weeks of gluten-free diet weekly, and each symptom should be scored from 1, regarded as very mild, to 10, regarded as very severe, and a decrease of the baseline score of at least 30% in 3 symptoms is regarded as suggestive of non-celiac gluten with sensitivity. Where are we for biomarkers for non-celiac gluten with sensitivity? Many attempts, but no diagnostic tests have been identified. The most interesting attempts concern the following items: the antibodies to native gliadin of IgG class found in about 50% of these patients, the increased serum secretion of a chemokine 6CL10 from peripheral blood mononuclear cells of these patients stimulated by different fraction of gluten, and the increased serum levels of zonulin, a marker of increased intestinal permeability, which resulted to be higher in non-celiac gluten with sensitivity, significantly higher versus controls and patients with IBS, and even higher without reaching the statistical significance versus celiac disease. And moreover, together with Roberto De Giorgio, we found an increased density of mast cells in the intestinal biopsy of this patient, in the duodenal biopsy, with a close vicinity of mast cells to nerves, which can be regarded as responsible for the generation of abdominal pain. Many attempts, but no biomarkers have been identified. Recently, our group, in cooperation with the Celiac Disease Center of Columbia University, carried out this study aimed to identify serum intestinal cell damage and systemic immune activation markers in individuals with suspected non-celiac gluten wheat sensitivity. We identified six possible biomarkers: IgM antibodies to gliadin, lipopolysaccharide binding protein, soluble CD14, IgM antibodies to endotoxin core, IgM antibodies to flagellin, and fatty acid binding protein 2. Three of six biomarkers showed significantly higher levels in non-celiac gluten wheat sensitivity versus celiac disease and healthy controls. These three biomarkers were lipopolysaccharide binding protein, soluble CD14, and IgM antibodies to endotoxin core. And the principal score analysis by means of these six biomarkers allowed to differentiate non-celiac gluten wheat sensitivity from celiac disease and healthy controls with some outliers. This result need to be confirmed by further study before the application of these biomarkers in the clinical practice. In the absence of biomarkers, the only way to confirm the real existence of non-celiac gluten wheat sensitivity is to perform a double-blind placebo-controlled trial with crossover. Unfortunately, this procedure is difficult to adopt in the clinical practice, is time-consuming, and the few double-blind placebo-controlled trials performed so far gave discordant results, mainly due to the different selection of patients and the different amount of gluten or wheat used in the different studies. One of the studies was performed by our group in cooperation with the University of Pavia. We tested 61 patients with suspected non-celiac gluten wheat sensitivity, administrating gluten-containing capsules, 4-3-75 grams in a day versus placebo rice starch, and we observed a significant worsening in overall symptoms after gluten ingestion versus placebo. However, the analysis of the individual patient scores showed that only 15% of subjects had a significant worsening of symptoms when ingesting gluten capsules versus placebo. And the same result had been obtained by Luca Elli in another study published in Nutrients in 2016. Only 14% of patients with suspected non-celiac gluten wheat sensitivity were confirmed as having this syndrome, and a higher level of patient was confirmed to have non-celiac gluten wheat sensitivity in the study from Zanini and colleagues, 34%. So based on this study, only 20% of patients with suspected non-celiac gluten wheat sensitivity can be confirmed to have a true syndrome, a true non-celiac gluten wheat sensitivity, whereas the remaining 80% of patients are not affected from this syndrome, and probably other factors can be involved in determining this condition, including the placebo-nocebo effect. The FODMAP intolerance due to the ingestion not only of wheat, but plenty of food containing FODMAPs, and without ruling out the possibility of other food hypersensitivity, without ruling out the possibility that some of these patients can be affected by early stages of celiac disease. Together with gluten, ATIs play a relevant role in this syndrome. ATIs are a family of AP11 similar small and compact proteins containing wheat. They are drivers of intestinal inflammation, vitol-like receptor 4, and they play a pathogenic role in gluten sensitivity activating innate immunity. A recent paper showed that modern hexaploid wheat and barley and rye contain a very high ATI content, as much as 100-fold higher compared to other cereals, whereas a low ATI content is present in older wheat variants such as spelt, emmer, anchored, as well as in gluten-free cereals. Moreover, in this study, interestingly enough, an increased intestinal secretion of inflammatory mediators, IL-8, TNF-alpha, IL-15, was observed at intestinal level in mice fed with ATI-free and gluten-free diet for 4 weeks with the following single gavage of commercial ATI containing gluten, whereas no increase of inflammatory mediators was observed in these mice when they received the same dose of gluten without ATIs, so pointing out that ATIs can have a relevant role in this syndrome. As for FODMAPs, Jessica Bieser-Kreisky illustrated very well their role, and I think that several studies showed that low FODMAP diet can improve intestinal symptoms in patients with IBS and also in patients with IBS together with non-celiac gluten wheat sensitivity. These studies can have some limitation due to the lack of a double blind, the choice of placebo, such as habitual diet, and the short term of the studies, 3 days to some weeks. And I stress again the possible risk of a low FODMAP diet due to the nutritional absorption of some nutrients, such as low calcium and fiber intake, the psychological risk leading to eating disorders, and gut microbiota changes. And for all these reasons, I think that it is cautionarily suggested to prescribe this diet only for some weeks and not in the long term. A recent intriguing research performed by confocal laser endomicroscopy supports the existence of wheat sensitivity in patients with functional gastrointestinal disorders. These authors administered via endoscope to duodenal mucosa food antigens, including wheat, cow's milk, soy, and they observed a real-time response to food antigens characterized by increased intraepithelial lymphocytes, epithelial leaks gaps, and widened intervillous spaces in more than 50% of these patients, particularly when they administered wheat, so supporting the existence of this syndrome. My final take-home message is that non-celiac gluten wheat sensitivity is a syndrome characterized by gastrointestinal, IBS-like, and extraintestinal symptoms elicited by gluten and wheat ingestion. Before suspecting or before diagnosing a patient as affected by suspected non-celiac gluten wheat sensitivity, both celiac disease and wheat allergy must be ruled out. That it means that no patient should start a gluten-free diet without a previous evaluation in a specialized center. Although the number of patients with suspected non-celiac gluten wheat sensitivity has been reported in the literature as high as up to 6% in the general population, only 1/5 of these patients are confirmed to be true gluten wheat sensitive by double-blind placebo-controlled trials. And no biomarker is available so far for identifying this syndrome. And for this reason, double-blind placebo-controlled trial with crossover is the only way for confirming this syndrome and the best way for identifying the true culprits of this syndrome is to perform a double-blind placebo-controlled trial with crossover by using 4 arms, including gluten, pure gluten, ATIs, fructans, and placebo. And despite the awareness of its existence, documented by the plenty of patients referring symptoms after gluten wheat ingestion, this condition remain an undecipherable puzzle with many questions without a definite answer. And before concluding, let me thank my dear friends and co-workers, Professor Roberto De Giorgio from the University of Bologna, Professor Armin Alaedini from the Celiac Disease Center of Columbia University, the expert group of gluten-related disorders, who helped me in studying this condition. Thank you very much for your attention.